Hello, Copperheads. My name is Kupri, and I'm still a little bit sick, so I apologize in advance if I sniffle or cough today. Anyways, we've had a couple of unusual weeks here on this channel. Last Wednesday, I didn't post a video because I was sick, but the Sunday before that, I posted a bonus April Fool's video, which you can find on a new playlist I have created called Making Fun of Serious Business. And in case you haven't noticed, this video you're watching right now and all the educational videos are in a playlist called Wilson's Disease Explained. Anyways, 2 weeks ago in Copperheads 8, we talked about two tests that can help us assess the copper situation in your body: total serum copper and 24-hour urine copper. As I mentioned in that video, low total serum copper and high 24-hour urine copper strongly indicate Wilson's disease. But having normal or even high total serum copper and or normal 24-hour urine copper doesn't always rule out a Wilson's disease diagnosis, and many cases require further testing. There's many reasons for this, which I covered in Copperhead 7 and Copperhead 8. For example, if your concentration of serum ceruloplasmin is low, but your concentration of total serum copper is high, it might be because you have Wilson's disease and you have high levels of free serum copper. There are several techniques that can be used to measure the concentration of free serum copper, but they either have not been evaluated on large-scale clinical trials or are not yet available in most clinical labs. As a result of these two factors, most people who are in the process of confirming or excluding a Wilson's disease diagnosis cannot directly find out their concentration of free serum copper. We can, however, try to estimate it with some mathematical calculations. But before we talk about math, let's talk about eggs. Imagine you have a bunch of eggs on your kitchen counter. For some reason, you cannot see or touch anything, but you know there's 100 eggs and that some of them are in groups of 6 inside cartons. You know that the eggs inside the cartons are pretty safe, but you're concerned about the eggs that are hanging out freely because they might roll off the counter, fall on the floor, and break. You also know that there's 10 cartons, and you want to find out how many free eggs you have, and therefore how concerned you should be about having a mess in your kitchen in the near future. So, you do some math. First, you want to figure out how many eggs are inside cartons. So, 10 cartons times 6 eggs per 1 carton. Cartons dividing and cartons multiplying cancel each other out, and we do the top and bottom math separately. So this equals 10 times 6 equals 60 eggs inside cartons. In other words, the amount of carton-contained eggs is 60 eggs. Now you know the total eggs, which is 100, and the amount of carton-contained eggs, which is 60, and you deduce that the remaining eggs are free eggs. So you calculate 100 minus 60 equals 40. And now you're like, oh no, 40 free eggs, it's gonna be a mess. But wait a minute, there's a few things you didn't consider. You're assuming that all 10 cartons are full, and you're assuming that there's no other container where the eggs might be. Even if it's true that there are 60 eggs inside 10 cartons, you still don't know if there are eggs in other containers, such as bowls or those little cups that are designed to hold one egg. So at most, this calculation you just did is gonna tell you the amount of eggs that are not inside cartons. In other words, the non-carton contained eggs. We can write this as a formula. Non-carton contained eggs equals total eggs minus carton contained eggs, which equals total eggs minus open bracket C cartons times EX per carton, close bracket. And remember that when using this formula, you have to do the stuff inside the bracket first. So, if instead of eggs we're talking about serum copper, and instead of cartons we're talking about ceruloplasmin, we can use a similar formula to find out the amount of non-ceruloplasmin-bound serum copper. Non-ceruloplasmin-bound serum copper equals total serum copper minus ceruloplasmin-bound serum copper. And I will show you in a minute how to calculate the ceruloplasmin-bound serum copper. Some sources show some version of this formula and say that this is how you calculate free serum copper, but that's actually incorrect. The same way that some of the eggs on the counter might be in other containers such as bowls and cups instead of inside cartons, some of the copper in your blood serum is bound to other molecules such as transcuprine and albumin instead of to ceruloplasmin. Some sources also show you this formula and tell you that this is how you calculate the free copper index or the copper index. I personally think that non-ceruloplasmin bound serum copper is the best term, but since it's kind of long and clunky, and I'm gonna be saying it many times in this video, today I'm just gonna call it NCB serum copper. To be perfectly clear, this is not a standard medical abbreviation, and in general, you should always call it non-ceruloplasmin bound serum copper. So let's talk about NCB serum copper. If you do not have Wilson's disease or any other condition that directly or indirectly affects your copper metabolism, the amount of NCB serum copper is usually going to be between 0 and 10% of the total. If you do have untreated Wilson's disease, the amount of NCB serum copper might be between 30 and 50% of the total. Additionally, the European guidelines say that NCB serum copper concentrations above 200 micrograms per liter strongly indicate Wilson's disease. The American guidelines are a bit more strict and say that values above 250 micrograms per liter strongly indicate Wilson's disease. But here is one problem. Even though both sets of guidelines talk about NCB serum copper in the text, they don't include it in the diagnostic algorithm. This is, in my opinion, a big mistake on their part, because as a result, most doctors and labs don't even know they should be calculating this value. Even before I started Wilson's disease Copperheads, I helped a lot of people with these calculations, and right now I want to teach you how to do it yourself. If you do the math and you're not totally sure it's correct, feel free to send me a message or email and I'll be happy to double check it for you. So first, we need to know the total serum copper. A lab can measure this from a blood sample. Second, we need to know the ceruloplasmin bound serum copper. We can calculate this if we know how much holoceruloplasmin we have. I told you in Copperhead 7 that holoceruloplasmin is the form of ceruloplasmin that is bound to 6 copper atoms. Thanks to being bound to these 6 copper atoms, it can do its job as an enzyme and is therefore biologically active. I also told you in that video that holoceruloplasmin can be tested using an enzymatic method. What I didn't really explain is that some enzymatic methods yield a concentration value, for example, in terms of milligrams of holoceruloplasmin per liter of serum, but this is very rarely done in clinical labs. The enzymatic method most clinical labs use gives us an activity value in terms of enzymatic units per volume of serum. One enzymatic unit of ceruloplasmin is the amount of ceruloplasmin it takes to react with 1 micromole of substrate in 1 minute at a certain temperature. Unfortunately, different labs use different substrates and different temperatures, so enzymatic units are arbitrary, which means they're not standardized across labs. 1 liter is the same everywhere, but 1 enzymatic unit of ceruloplasmin can mean different things depending on the lab and the tools they use. Also, unfortunately, an activity value will not really help us calculate the concentration of ceruloplasmin-bound copper. I mean, it's technically possible, but it's very difficult, and most clinical labs are not gonna collect or provide you with the extra data you need to make this calculation. In practice, this means that in most cases, we have to rely on the ceruloplasmin concentration obtained with an immunological method, which, as I told you in Copperhead 7, does not distinguish between holoceruloplasmin, which is bound to 6 copper atoms, and apoceruloplasmin, which is not bound to any copper atoms. I'm gonna tell you why this matters by teaching you how to calculate ceruloplasmin-bound serum copper and NCB serum copper. Let's go! Let's take a hypothetical person A, who we know for sure is unaffected by Wilson's disease. They are not a carrier and they are not a patient. Additionally, they are totally healthy and don't have any other condition that directly or indirectly affects their copper metabolism. A blood test has told us that they have a total serum copper concentration of 900 micrograms per liter, which is pretty much in the middle of the normal range. Another test performed on the same blood sample has measured their serum ceruloplasmin concentration using an immunological method, and the result is 300 milligrams per liter, which is exactly in the middle of the normal range. Since the serum ceruloplasmin was measured immunologically, we don't know exactly what portion of that is holoceruloplasmin, so let's just assume a pretty average figure of 90%. And finally, we know from the European and American guidelines that 1 milligram of holoceruloplasmin transports 3.15 micrograms of copper. So let's first calculate the amount of ceruloplasmin-bound serum copper. First fraction, 90 per 100, because that's what 90% means. multiplied by a second fraction, 300 milligrams of ceruloplasmin per 1 liter of serum, multiplied by a third fraction, 3.15 micrograms of copper per 1 milligram of ceruloplasmin. The milligrams of ceruloplasmin at the top of the second fraction and at the bottom of the third fraction cancel each other out. Let's clean this up by writing an equal sign and a longer fraction line. At the top, we have 90 times 300 times 3.15 milligrams of copper, and at the bottom, we have 100 liters of serum. We do the top and bottom math separately, so that's 85,050 at the top divided by 100 at the bottom. The result is 850.5 micrograms of ceruloplasmin-bound serum copper per 1 liter of serum, or 850.5 micrograms per liter. So now that we know the ceruloplasmin-bound serum copper, let's calculate the NCB serum copper. NCB serum copper equals total serum copper minus ceruloplasmin-bound serum copper equals 900 minus 850.5 equals 49.5 micrograms per liter. 49.5 micrograms per liter is below 200 micrograms per liter, so that's consistent with the fact that person A is unaffected by Wilson's disease and has a normal copper metabolism. If we want to express NCB serum copper as a percentage of the total, which is 900 micrograms, we write 900 micrograms is 100%, so 49.5 micrograms is X percent. We write X equals in a fraction line. At the bottom, we write the value across from the X, so that's 900 at the bottom. And at the top, we multiply the other two values, so that's 49.5 times 100 at the top. We do the top and bottom math separately, and the result is 5.5%. 5.5% is below 10%, so again, that's consistent with the fact that person A is unaffected by Wilson's disease and has a normal copper metabolism. This is only if we assume that 90% of ceruloplasmin is in the hollow form. But what if it's not 90%? What happens if we do the same math assuming it's 100% or 80%? Let's save ourselves some effort and make a spreadsheet. In the first column, we have total serum copper in micrograms per liter, so I'm just gonna write 900 11 times. In the second column, we have serum ceruloplasmin in milligrams per liter, so I write 311 times. In the third column, we have the assumed percentage of hollow ceruloplasmin, so I write 100, then 90, then 80, etc. In the fourth column, we have NCB serum copper in micrograms per liter, so I enter the formula we were using in a way the spreadsheet can understand, and then drag down so it's applied to all the rows. And finally, in the fifth column, we have NCB serum copper as a percentage of the total. So I enter the relevant formula and drag down to apply it to all the rows. Finally, I make the fourth and fifth columns have one decimal figure, so it's easier to see the results. As you see, when we assume that 90% of the ceruloplasmin is in the hollow form, we get the results we calculated earlier using pen and paper. When we assume that 100% of the ceruloplasmin is in the hollow form, we get a negative number. The reason we get a negative number here is that we're overestimating the amount of ceruloplasmin-bound serum copper, because nobody has 100% of ceruloplasmin in the hollow form. And anyways, this might not always be a negative number. For example, if the total serum copper was 950 instead of 900 milligrams per liter, the NCB serum copper expressed as a percentage of the total would be 0.5% instead of minus 5%. On the other hand, when we assume that 60% of the ceruloplasmin is in the hollow form, we get that 37% of the total serum copper is NCB serum copper. Please consider that it makes no sense to assume that a person with a normal copper metabolism would have only 60% of ceruloplasmin in the hollow form. However, I'm showing you what happens when we assume 100%, 90%, 80%, etc. of ceruloplasmin in the hollow form, because I want you to notice this trend. When we assume higher percentages of hollow ceruloplasmin, we get lower concentrations of NCB serum copper and vice versa. In other words, if we assume that 100% of the ceruloplasmin is in the hollow form, we get the lowest and most conservative estimate for NCB serum copper. Now let's take some hypothetical person B who shows some symptoms of Wilson's disease and is in the process of confirming or excluding a Wilson's disease diagnosis. Their total serum copper is 1350 micrograms per liter, which is within the normal range but almost too high, and their serum ceruloplasmin was measured immunologically and it is 210 milligrams per liter, which is within the normal range but almost too low. A random person might look at this and say, well, both the total serum copper and the serum ceruloplasmin are within the normal range, so person B cannot have Wilson's disease. But we know a lot more about Wilson's disease than this random person, and we think it's definitely suspicious that the total serum copper is so high while the serum ceruloplasmin is so low, even if both values are technically but only barely within the normal range. We suspect this is because person B has a lot of free serum copper, but since we don't have the means to measure free serum copper directly, we do the best we can, which is to calculate NCB serum copper. So I'm just going to copy this part of the spreadsheet down here and substitute person B's test results. Oh, check out what happened. When we assume that 100% of ceruloplasmin is in the hollow form, person B has 51% of NCB serum copper. That is really high and strongly suggests a Wilson's disease diagnosis. And this 51% is the most conservative estimate. As we know, Wilson's disease patients have a much lower percentage of ceruloplasmin in the hollow form. So, for example, if person B actually has 60% of ceruloplasmin in the hollow form, then they have 70.6% of NCB serum copper. So, the take-home message is, when considering the possibility of a Wilson's disease diagnosis, you should always pay attention to the NCB serum copper. If you are lucky and your lab has the technology to measure it directly, then you don't need to do any math. Otherwise, if you know your total serum copper in micrograms per liter and your serum ceruloplasmin in milligrams per liter, you can use the following formula. Non-ceruloplasmin-bound serum copper in micrograms per liter equals total serum copper in micrograms per liter minus, open bracket, 3.15 times serum ceruloplasmin in milligrams per liter, close brackets, and make sure to do the part inside the brackets first. And remember to check these three things. Number one, make sure that the total serum copper and serum ceruloplasmin were measured from the same blood sample, not from blood samples collected on different days, because these values do fluctuate a bit. Number two, make sure that they are in the correct units. For example, if your serum ceruloplasmin is in milligrams per deciliter instead of milligrams per liter, the formula is not going to work out. You need to convert the serum ceruloplasmin value to milligrams per liter first. And if you don't remember how to do this, feel free to check out Copperhead 6. And number three, remember that if your serum ceruloplasmin concentration was measured immunologically, the above formula is going to give you the most conservative estimate by assuming that 100% of your ceruloplasmin is in the hollow form. But if your serum ceruloplasmin concentration was measured enzymatically, you can still use the formula, and actually you're lucky because the estimate is going to be much more accurate. Alright, Copperheads, that's all for today. I'm sorry this video has been quite long, but I wanted to make sure you really understood this very important topic. Come back next week to keep learning more about the Wilson's disease diagnostic process. Until then, you can find me on YouTube, Instagram, Facebook, or by email. My name is Kupri. See you there, Copperheads!